Good afternoon. Do you know which place is this? Wait, I'll have to show you the greenery, all right? Look at this. We are at this beautiful place called Nandi Hills. And Ali is going live from here today. Yeah, we are on a top of this hill. And you can see all that settlements and habitats below there. So that is where, from where we will be going live today. I may be appearing very shiny, blurred and all, but it's worth the while. So we thought that for the exam of life, even we need to get ready. And so our readiness is usually by taking some short breaks whenever possible. Yes, that's what we do. We just come, we do some chillax. And this place, see, I'll just show you. Yeah. It is called Gandhi Nilaya. Yes. And we also have Nikat with us.
Hi.
You want to tell them a hi? So we are trying to get, you know, as, what do you say, tech friendly and do a lot of things as much as possible for you. So here's Ali and we start today's FB Live from Nandi Hills live.
Yes, I think it is 2 o'clock and as usual sharp we start and 2:30 sharp I stop, even though people take time to log in, doesn't matter. I always appreciate those who are punctual and who have logged in on time and I don't want to make them wait. I value their time very much. So, let me start with today's topic, which I have called childhood baggage. Baggage in the sense something that we are carrying. What do we normally talk about baggage, you know? If I have some knapsack or something on my back, I say that that is a baggage that I am carrying. Or even if I'm holding it in my hand or whatever it is. So we refer to baggage as something that, you know, you carry with you. And whenever you have some baggage with you, obviously it slows you down. You can't walk or run or proceed as fast as you would normally like to do when you have some baggage to carry. And if that baggage becomes too heavy, then you sometimes start getting tired, you want to take a break, you want to stop, you want to see whether you can find some other means of transport, all that goes on, isn't it? Now that is physical baggage. Today, obviously, I'm going to talk about mental, emotional baggage. So what happens is that most of us, thankfully, go through a happy childhood. We have parents who care, love, take care of us, give us that sense not only of being loved, but also of being secure, of having somebody, you know, who takes care of us and the world is fine because anything and everything, I can go running back to my daddy or my mommy and they will take care of it. Similarly, as we grow up, if we are very lucky, we have teachers who care and love for us. We have our small group of friends or somebody or even relatives and extended family who are taking care of us. So we say, yes, I am happy and I'm, you know, taking care of whatever it is. As we grow up, some of us unfortunately go through some unfortunate events, some unpleasant events. Sometimes it can be very, very traumatic. Sometimes it can be minor thing, but something which doesn't go away easily. Sometimes it can be a series of small things, which if I look at each one of them independently, they don't seem to be having much effect. I don't even feel like telling anybody because it's so small and so minor that I feel people will laugh at me. But if you have 10 small things which have disturbed you, what happens? Obviously, you know, the whole thing adds up, it piles up. You're also aware that stress is cumulative. any stress that I have gone through, and particularly if it is unresolved, it adds up to the next stressor, then the next, then the next. So by the time I grow up, depending on how many stressful incidents or experiences I have gone through, determine how I am going to lead my adult life. And many of us have this habit of thinking, oh, that happened when I was very small. Yeah, that time I was very upset, I was crying, all that was happening. But I have grown up now as an adult, you know, what's the point in talking about all these things? They're so far gone, so what is so the big issue about it? We tend to ignore it. Because we think that as adults, we should be able to face all types of situations. We should be able to face anything that is coming our way. And what is coming our way in our adult life is far more serious than what happened in our childhood. For such a small thing, why am I making an issue? Why am I bothered what happened to me at that time? It is over and done with, no? So what's the point in even talking about it now? That is how the whole thing goes. And it is not just the bad experiences or incidents that we went through. What is equally important, or maybe more important, is how did I resolve them? What did I do after that? What sort of support I got? Was I able to come to terms with what happened to me and then proceed with life? Or did I just suppress that, ignore that, and went on with life thinking that this is okay, that has happened, that is a past, that is not to be bothered about. So as we grow up, sometimes we get a feeling that something is holding me back from fully embracing life's joys and forming deep connections with others. We start asking this question to ourselves, what's wrong with me? Why do I feel like I'm running on empty? How can I fix it? You might suffer anxiety or some amount of depression or a difficulty. You feel that sense of, you know, being let down or something, or a sense of loss of direction or something like that. If as an adult, you're getting that feeling, it could be, for example, midlife crisis, because you are feeling directionless because you hit midlife and you're not very sure from here, where do I go or what is my direction? What should I do? It could be something like that. It could be a major trauma. I've lost my job, or I've had a major accident, or I've had a loss of relationship. That's also possible. When that happens, we know that something has to be done. But if nothing like that, is happening, I am not, you know, feeling or experiencing anything which is negative right now. Even then, I'm not feeling fully charged up. I'm not feeling that, yes, I can move on in life. I can do thing. What is it that is happening? We get confused. And what we do is, at times, we look for what I would call as symptomatic relief. You know, it's like if I have a fever or headache, to bring down the symptoms, what do? I take a paracetamol, Crocin, Dolo, whatever you want to call it. And within no time, the fever comes down or the headache goes away. So I feel very happy that yes, I had this fever and I've taken this thing and it has come down. But you know what I've done? I have only sought and got symptomatic relief. That means the symptoms came down, but the issue is not resolved. Why did I get that fever or that cough or that headache in the first place? There is some infection. There is some viral. There is something happening inside me. And that is what I need to tackle on the long-term basis, isn't it? So some people, some of us, whenever we feel upset, whenever we feel something is wrong, we look for a cause. If there is a cause, we say, yeah, I'm very upset because my grandmother passed away or because, you know, my job got lost or something like that has happened to me. Then I justify and I say, yes, it is because of this that this has, you know, happened. And I'll see how I can resolve it. But it does happen sometimes that I find I have nothing that happened to me in the recent past. Or even in the distant past, 1 year, 2 years, 5 years back also, nothing bad happened to me, or whatever bad happened, I have resolved it. So today, as an adult, whatever your age is, if you feel that there is something incomplete in you, then it is necessary that we go back into our past. I am almost a follower of Sigmund Freud. You know, Sigmund Freud went to the extreme of saying that whatever happens to you in the first few years of your life becomes a script which you just follow for the rest of your life. The script of your life has already been written in the first 6, 7, 8 years, he says. Those experiences determine how the rest of your life will be, how you will enact and what you will do. That was an extreme. So obviously not many people liked it. And that's the reason why, despite Sigmund Freud being the top person whom we recognize as the father of modern psychotherapies, but most of his followers broke away and moved on because he was not open to discussion on certain things which he used to propagate. But there is a lot of sense in what he says. That is, the childhood plays a major role. I would not go to the extent of saying that it is a script, but I would definitely say that childhood plays a major role in our life, regardless of whether you are 30 or 60 or whatever your age is. And more so, one is, of course, the influences of life. You see, for example, if certain moral values have been imbibed me as a child, it remains with me lifelong. Even years and decades later, I don't want to change. I stick to my values, my principles. Similarly, if something negative has happened, if something, you know, where you know, somebody has sort of imbibed into me that you need not be honest, you need not be too, you know, Harish Chandra type of person being honest in everything. Life is like that. Everybody does this. And following that, if your significant elders, adults, have been following a particular path, even that can lead to such a strong feeling that, no, I have to, I can, and I will break all these morals and I will do whatever I want. So either way, good or bad, the significance, the influence of our childhood remains. Those of us who have worked it out, who have introspected and thought over that this is what my childhood was, these are the pluses, these are the minuses, these are the issues which remain unresolved and I should do something about it, those are the happy ones. Because they have been able to remove the baggage of their childhood, have a clean slate, and have moved on into their adult life. But not all of us have done that. Some of us have tried to suppress. We have taken paracetamol. And we have thought, yes, that fever is gone and I can go ahead and do whatever I want. Unfortunately, it doesn't work that way. Whatever happened in our childhood, and if it is unresolved, it plays a strong role. Take an extreme case like child abuse. Whenever I have, you know, dealt with adult survivors of child abuse, I have found that those who went through very bad child abuse also, but they got emotional support immediately after that. They got somebody to hold their hand, somebody to hug them and say, don't worry, I'm there with you, nothing will happen to you. Those are the ones who could resolve it. Whereas those who went through any form of abuse, even if it's a very light and a very slight abuse, but it was followed by somebody putting me down. You must have done something bad. That is why this happened to you. Don't complain about this. Why are you saying this? Are you sure this you're telling the right thing, or are you telling lies? When that happens, the trauma doubles up, triples up. And we find ourselves rudderless, directionless. Yes, I have my elders, I have my family, I have my teachers, I have everybody around me. But I think of myself as an outcast, as a person who doesn't deserve to get the best. My self-esteem goes down. My desire to create a better life for myself, that goes down. And as I start going down, things get more and more, convoluted. Okay, leaving out something as serious as child abuse, there could be, for example, that I have been brought up in a dysfunctional family. A dysfunctional family is one in which there is no harmony, there is no joy, there is no happiness. Mother and father did not separate or divorce. They lived under the same roof till the end of their life. But they did not live as husband and wife. They had constant arguments. Things were very unpleasant. As a child, if growing up you felt so uneasy, so uncomfortable that this is what my daddy and mommy are doing, you would have felt extremely unhappy. It doesn't matter what they were unhappy about, what they were arguing about. Similarly, a dysfunctional family can be one in which there is no communication. They've had their fights, they've decided that, we can't be friends, we can't be together. But traditionally that too, the earlier generation and all that, people would not divorce, people would not separate out. They somehow hung on. So the husband and wife would be there under the same roof. As far as the whole society is concerned, they are a couple and they are living together. But they are not really a functional family in the sense daddy doesn't talk to mommy directly. Daddy tells you, go and tell your mother this, this, this. Mommy says, go and tell your daddy this, this, this. When that happens, the child feels very, very uncomfortable. And these are the things which cause what we call as a dysfunctional family. Okay, even if that didn't happen to us, it could also be something simple as being put down or scolded for no fault of mine. If I have a father who has been constantly putting me down, scolding me, there have been fathers who have always given preference to the boy child and have scolded the girl child as though you are nobody. However good the girl child is, they have been putting her down. Now when that girl child grows up, what happens to her self-esteem? What happens to her feeling of security in life? Another factor is comparison. If in childhood I have been compared with others, look at your brother, he is doing so well. Look at that cousin who is like this, like this. Look at your classmates, they are so good. What's wrong with you? If I have been facing that type of situation, that it also has pulled me down. Today as an adult, if I want to be functional, I want to do something important. Let's say I want to finalize a very important deal, or I want to deal with some customer or impress my boss. The first thought that strikes me in my subconscious mind, not in my conscious mind, it strikes in my subconscious mind that, am I good enough? Will I get this contract? Will my boss approve of me? Will this person really become friends with me? Does my spouse love me? These are the type of questions that start coming in the mind. And because of that, my effort goes down and my performance goes down. If somebody has made me feel unwanted, there are children whose parents are so insensitive, they say things like, why were you born? We didn't want you in our family. You are such a stupid thing. You are making things worse for us. If you were not there, we would have been happy. I don't know in what fit of anger or frustration they make these statements, but it can leave a lifetime impact on the child. If there have been some form of trauma, being beaten up, being scolded, being given names, being bullied, having been body shamed, all these are the baggage or scars that we carry into our adult life. If we are not conscious of the fact that these have to be resolved, we will not be in a position to lead a perfectly normal life as we could. Any small stressor becomes, in addition to the stressor which already, we have been through. And the funny thing is that this baggage often remains hidden in our subconscious mind until it is triggered by similar situations or some intense emotional experiences. Simple thing I told you, okay, I have to give a presentation to my customer or my boss or something. I'm an expert in my subject. I can prepare very well and I can bring out something which, the person should be really impressed with. I know that. I've done it before so many times and I'm capable of it. But if I'm carrying some of these dark childhood experiences where, for example, my father, my teacher or somebody told me, what great you think of yourself, is it? You're no good. Don't think that just because you have prepared this talk or you have done this assignment, you are somebody great. Anybody could have done that assignment. Somebody would have, XYZ would have done a better job of it. You are not capable. You will never succeed. A statement like you will never succeed carries sometimes 10 years, 20 years, 40 years. And now I am grown up. I am competent. I have made all my efforts. And I want to move on and do something in life. And this old record is playing at the back of my head. You are no good. You are not capable. You will never succeed. Now, what do we do at a practical level? That's also something that we need to look into. That's very important. Firstly, when you make a list and recall any small or big incidents that happened in your childhood. See here, remember one very important thing, that this isn't bashing your parents or your elders who may have done something bad to you. This is about bringing some clarity to your current state of mind and to help you feel better about your past life. So sometimes people don't want to even go back in the past because they say, yes, I do vaguely remember that my father used to put me down, or my mother used to say these horrible things, or my grandmother used to say that, or whatever. My teacher used to scold me. I don't want to think about it because these same people did so much for me. They've done such good things for me. Just because they did one or two bad things, can I now make a big issue out of it and say, this has happened to me? It's not fair, no? It is fair. What you are doing is not bashing up that person or accusing that person that you were bad to me when I was a child. You are only going to resolve within yourself. You don't even have to meet and tell the other person. You continue with whatever relationship you have with the person, or you don't have with that person, or even if the person is gone. What you need to do is to list out. And in that list out, what you felt. When daddy scolded me, I felt I will never be able to succeed in life. I am good for nothing. I compared myself with my elder brother and felt that I will never come up to the standard of my elder brother. What I felt, what I thought, that needs to be, recorded. Once you record for each of those instances, what were your emotional outlets? Some people straight away argued. They went into a discussion or argument with their elder, teacher, father and said, no, that is wrong. Very courageous, very brave as a small child. Not everybody can do it. But if somebody did that, at least there was some relief. As you know that as children, you're not supposed to back answer. You're not supposed to make comments. You're not supposed to say anything. You're supposed to be obliging them. You're supposed to be obedient when they are talking, even when they are talking something which is unreasonable. So when that happens, what did I do? I did not get the required emotional outlet. Then comes the other thing. Who supported me at that time? Yes, mummy said these horrible things, but my grandmother put me in her lap, gave me a hug and said, you are a darling baby, you're a very good child. Forget about what mummy said. Maybe she was angry or frustrated, that's why she may have said it. But I know that you're a good child, I know that you're capable. That would have played wonders. That is like immediately putting a balm on your wound. And the wound starts healing much faster. On the other hand, did it affect my self-esteem? We need to check. What was my coping mechanism? Some of us in childhood have a good coping mechanism. We go and start playing. We start chanting some mantras. We start doing something. Some of us even had, if you recollect, you know, imaginary friends. So I would sit in my room and start chatting with that friend. And that friend would give me all the support. And I would feel nice. Yes, see, my friend is supporting me. So any of this form of, you know, support, what was my coping mechanism? Innumerable people have different types of coping mechanisms. If you had that, then yes, you would have been able to resolve it to a greater or a lesser extent. Lastly, did you suppress or did you resolve? There's a difference between the two. Sometimes when we know something bad has happened to us, we just suppress it. We don't even want to think about it. We go quiet on that and say, okay, it has happened, it is over. Even if my elders or friends or whoever is not willing to support, what's the point in talking? I can't turn the clock back. I can't again redo something which is already over. So what's the point in even talking about it? Let me accept it and move on. No? That's the type of attitude which we take, but it's an attitude out of frustration, let me tell you. And that attitude doesn't help because you only suppressed it and you not resolved it. Like I gave the example of paracetamol versus doing something to actually get rid of the infection. And that leads to a scenario where today as an adult, even if you're successful, even if you're in good work, even if people are praising you, you somehow feel that no, life is not all that great. I'm not very happy with life. Somewhere there is a vacuum still existing. That vacuum, that unresolved baggage does not allow me to be fully happy. A person who has achieved something, won an award or got a big contract or whatever, you know, some great achievement has happened. At that moment, the person should be feeling absolutely happy, isn't it? But deep down, if the person says no, I don't know why, there is no reason. But I'm not really able to enjoy it the way I would have actually normally enjoyed myself. If that feeling is coming in, if you're feeling guilty about small things, you're doing something very minor and you feel guilty. You shout at your child and you feel guilty. You don't cook food one day and you feel guilty. If those things are happening to you, then you need to work on the thing. If you have a fear of being rejected or abandoned rather, if I'm not nice to somebody, that somebody will leave me and go away and I will be feeling alone. I will have nobody in my life. Such thoughts, when they come, it's an indication that you are suffering from low self-esteem. You are punishing yourself. You are being very cruel to yourself. Similarly, if you find that you are not willing to take risks, you want to remain in your comfort zone, you have an opportunity. You can get a promotion, you can change something, you can move forward, you can start some new venture, you can build a new house, whatever it is. But if you find yourself that you are not willing to take risks, and the same way, if you find that you are not able to maintain relationships, something is going wrong in my relationships. Relationships which were very happy, which I thought are going to be lifelong, and I realize that I'm not being able to maintain. The relationship is going down. We are not as happy with each other as we should have been. If that is happening to us, that is an indicator that we need to resolve the childhood baggage. And how do we do it? Has to be done at an individual level. It starts with something like I told you. Go back and recount everything that has happened. Write down what actually was the effect on you at that time and what is the effect now. Write down how your relationships are with those people, if they're still around, and your current people who are close to you. Write down why you are feeling so uncomfortable about what happened in the past. Talk it over with somebody reliable, saying that I don't want to take a risk because I'm scared. And what am I scared of? I'm scared that in my childhood I was told this. Let that person rationalize and tell you that no, you can do something now. Give yourself positive affirmations. Tell yourself that whatever happened in the past was not my fault. And just because I suffered then, I'm not going to continue to suffer even now. Now I am an adult. I am in control of my life and I can do whatever I want to do. Once you come to that stage, or you're even working towards that stage, it's not an ideal situation that one fine day you resolve and you're, you know, happy and hunky-dory. It doesn't happen that way. But the more you keep resolving and throwing away that childhood baggage, every kilo that you are, you know, removing from your backpack is making you feel that much easier and making you feel walk faster. Start that process, get into that journey, and you will realize that you are able to move on much better, carve out a better life. Whatever life has challenges to offer you now, work out and remove all the things that happened in the past and you will be able to move on. So with that, I come to the end of the first half of the session, and here is Purni to update you on what's happening with us, and then I'll be back in a minute.
Good afternoon. Hope you all are doing well, and hope you all are already trying different, thinking of different ways to offload your baggage. I was just listening to Ali keenly, and I was wondering that what possibly I would do if I had to, you know, work on myself and offload my baggage, possibly with someone whom I really bestow trust in. I would come to a nice, quiet, calm place where nature is at its best. And because if you are in the same routine environment of your home, you will be working with the paper wala coming, gas wala coming, cooking, doing this, doing that, doing a lot of things, no, usual. Then your maintenance female will come, then you'll give something to her. All that will keep happening. So I was just thinking, if I have to work on this, I would possibly come with a person in whom, as I told, I bestow trust, come down, spend a time. Or if I'm the solo types, possibly do you want to go for a solo trip and think, write down small things and work on yourself? That's up to you. So that's also something which you can do. And another thing which you can do is that if this is the opportunity that you are seeking to work on some very important relationships which matter to you a lot, but for some reason you know, may have gone a little haywire, an opportunity is there for you to come to Manthan. So February 16, 17, 18, that is that Friday, Saturday, Sunday, we are having a camp at Manthan on relationships, you know, how to anticipate change in this such fast technological world. Every day is a new day, and in the world of technology, so how do you anticipate change, in behaviors, in age, you know, how teenagers behave, how children behave, and also how to have your boundaries set. And for some, they also want to work on the emotional disconnect, and of course the word which is the buzzword today, social media, how to, you know, keep ourselves checked, whether I am very much into social media, not into social media, is it doing me good, is it doing me bad, all these and many, many more things, with many lively activities and wisdom words from Ali, will be at Manthan. So last time also the poster was sent across, we will be sending it across to you once again, so that you you know, remember to register. It is going to be from Friday evening till Sunday afternoon lunch, so you will be with us. We all will be there with you to introspect, to actualize, to think, to mull, and to discuss everything for you. If you think you want to work on your relationships, if you are happy, maybe you want to be a little more happier. So now, how do I take my baggage out? All questions and from you, and answers from Ali. So over to Ali, who will be here in just a minute. And this room, as I was telling you, we are at a very beautiful place, all full of nature.
Ah, thanks, Purni. The other thing that I wanted to tell was that I fixed up this topic next week called Making Friends with Plants. Generally, the moment we say making friends, we are talking about human beings. Some people extend that to making friends with animals. But hardly anybody makes friends with plants. And that's the reason why next week, in the salubrious environments of Manthan, I want you to experience what it means to make friends with plants. That's a completely different aspect of life to which we have not given any significance or any importance. We don't even consider plants as living beings with their own emotions and aspirations. So that is the reason why we will be there next week, if you can join us, or join us on this FB program next Saturday, which is on 17th of February at 2 o'clock. Now, in the meanwhile, we have had a few questions already. So Purni is going to read it out and I'm going to respond.
Ali Roshan Banaji says that being a follower of Louis Hay, who says suppression of emotion causes cramps in your body, I've experienced this, so it's better to talk to a good friend and pour out your heart. Unresolved issues in childhood could lead to mental illnesses in future. Mostly at the age of 18, till the issues are resolved, the person goes deeper into it and causes more major mental illness.
Yes, I agree with Roshan that suppression can, in extreme cases, even lead to, you know, illnesses, physical illness or mental illness. Again, nobody goes into all those details and causes. You go to a doctor, most doctors just treat you symptomatically. But a really good doctor would help you to go back right into your childhood, check out your genealogy, what your parents, grandparents went through in life, and what you inherited from them, then what was your childhood, and based on that, we will be able to, you know, resolve the things, which is absolutely essential. Even at times, if you're getting unexplained aches and pains or physical ailments which have no cause or no reason, check out whether there's something that you're carrying with you since your childhood. And same thing with the mental disturbances that I've already mentioned, that, you know, if you're unhappy, life is going fine, everybody is treating you well, everything is happening fine, but you're still unhappy, that means that there is something which you are carrying with you, which is not available at the conscious level, but which is there at the subconscious level. Yes.
So that's the one question we are waiting for others to come in.
Yeah. No, the first one, as soon as I started off, was Shobha, who was very concerned, and she was asking me whether I have a sunburn because she noticed my face. No, it's not a sunburn. It is some form of an allergy, which I don't know where I picked it up from. Hopefully it is going. I caught it a few days back, but I have a wonderful doctor who looks at these things holistically. This is something which I always advocate, that you should have a doctor, a physician, be it an allopath, be it a homeopath, be it an Ayurvedic doctor, but somebody who takes care of your basic, you know, total overall health. Not just, today I have fever, so he will give me medicine for fever. Today I have cough, so he will give me medicine for cough. Somehow I don't believe in that. Try and see if you can, you know, get one physician who knows your whole history, preferably who knows the history of your whole family. And you keep going back, and that person should have the ability to remember what happened to you 6 months and 6 years back, and accordingly deal with whatever are your ailments. That thing really helps a lot. So that is the...
So Ali, I was just thinking that a childhood baggage, it can affect, of course, marital life, and also the way we deal with our children.
Yes, yes, yes. Both these things are equally important, and I'm glad this has been brought up. Marital life. As you know, marriage can be a really wonderful thing. It can take you to the highest, you know, levels of heaven and ecstasy. And marriage is a relationship which can take you down into the deepest hell. Now, one of the factors is, what is the baggage that I carry into my marital relationship? I was a single person for 20 years, 30 years, and then I got married. So whatever I have had in experiences in those few decades, have I resolved that? I would really exhort all the young people, and those who are married, please tell your youngsters who are not yet married, to do this exercise of removing childhood baggage as much as possible before they enter into a lifelong partnership of marriage. And then it carries on to the children. Because I was treated in a particular way by my elders, the way I treat my children gets affected, and it can, you know, give a lot of problems to your own children. Don't allow that to happen.
Ali, Shobha is asking, if I have some baggage, how will I behave with the concerned people?
Yes, that is very important. See, some of us carry that grudge. Supposing somebody was very bad to me in my childhood. Now it's up to me. I can be so angry that I say, I don't want to talk to this person. I want to keep away from this person. Nothing wrong. But the more important thing is to resolve whatever happened to you, rather than just trying to ignore that person, if that person happens to be close to you, related to you, or still part of life. The other is that you go back and shout at them now, saying that, you know, what you did to me so many years back, it doesn't help. That person is obviously going to defend himself or herself, and matters can even become worse. But I tell you, if you have resolved the issues that were there since childhood, your ability to deal with these people becomes much better. You can forgive them. You can go past them, and you can say, I don't care who these people are or what they are. If I have to be nice to them a little bit here and there socially, I will do it. If I don't have to interact with them, I will not interact with them.
Smita says that parents are untrained in parenting, especially first-time parents. What advice would you give them to avoid creating these baggage in their children?
Absolutely right, Smita. You're very, very true. You remember one or two generations back, there used to be not only a stream of children for a couple, there also used to be joint families. So if a person is growing up, his elder brother or sister gets married, they have a child, and you see how they are parenting that child, you learn from them. You say, no, I think he is being too strict with his child. No, I think he is being too lenient with the child. I think the husband and wife are not on the same plane. They start giving different instructions and the child gets confused. So you even learn there. And then when you marry, you go into the parenting with some experience. And of course, those days when people used to have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 children, what mistakes you made from the first one, you learn from the second to the third to the fourth. That's how it goes. And they learn from each other. Even if there's an impact of bad parenting and the parent is bad to you, they would resolve it within themselves. All that is gone. So today, as Smita rightly said, if you are a person brought up in a nuclear family and you are now planning to become a parent or you've just become a parent few years back, please understand that your baggage plays a very important role and try to see what best you can do about it.
And Nikhat has given a good information. When the body says no, the cost of hidden stress by Dr. Gaber Mate is a good read on adverse childhood experiences and its impact on adult life and chronic health conditions.
Very, very true, Nikhat. It's a very important aspect. And I would exhort you people to read up, people like Dr. Gaber, and there are so many more. But I don't press that in because nowadays hardly anybody has time to read. They just don't read. So I feel like a fool if I say you read this book, you read that book. But whatever you can, at least a bit here and there, whenever you come across something good like this, at least what do you say? Browse on the internet and read up a bit of information, read 2-3 paragraphs. And if you get interested, if you find something good, then get the book and read the complete book. That's how life can really benefit from reading.
Ali, Smita adds that someone who carries deep hurts and deep emotions of anger and frustration against their parents finds it very difficult to come to terms, even if the parents came from a place of unpreparedness.
Very true, Smita. That is what I want you to understand. That if I am today going to resolve, and if I say that my parent did this which hurt me, please don't think of it as parent bashing. That how can I be bad to my parent? My parent also did 100 good things to me. So just because of this, how can I be bad to my parent? You are not being bad, I assure you. You are only resolving the trauma that you are carrying. That's all we need to do. You don't even have to go and meet your parents and tell them that I am upset about this. You resolve it from within.
And Roshan adds that to keep in good health, resolve every small issue that one has faced in never to suppress it. And Surekha has written that...
Respond to Roshan that you should resolve every small issue. That is something very important. I told you, sometimes we think, yes, this happened to me in my childhood. X said this to me. Y did this to me. But it was a very minor. And now I'm grown up. What's the point in going back to that history and creating that unpleasantness and thinking about those things? It's okay. They were also nice to me, no? But they did this bad thing. So what? No, it doesn't work that way. And as Roshan rightly said, you resolve every small issue. Then and then only you will be able to move on. Another of my baggage, it might sound funny today, is that I was labeled by my school friends as a drawing Dumbo. When I failed to draw a single bunch of grapes in the fourth standard, even today, I get upset about it. Yes, Rekha, these are the small things. That's what I'm talking about. That remains with you. Why is it that so many years after you finished your fourth standard, why is it that you are able to remember that label of drawing Dumbo? Because it hit you very badly. You were not even 10 years old at that time. It was your formative years. You were looking up to people, including your friends. And those friends put a label on you. just because you could not draw. Everybody is not very good in drawing. Like everybody is not good in maths or everybody is not good in something else. They, that little thing, and they would not even have done it with bad intentions. We are not even labeling those friends as bad or something. It happens, you know, it's just peer pressure or that, you know, gang thing where you just point out to one and start teasing her or something. But it is up to us to resolve it. That is important.
Shobha, thanks you.
Yes. Thanks, Shobha. You have always been very deeply concerned. You've been a person who really takes care of everybody and you have genuine interest, not only in your own students, but in all of us. It's been a pleasure to have you as part of Banjara. We always cherish people, all the people. You know, Smita, who just now made a comment, has done her DCS more than 20 years back, and she still keeps in touch, and I still value her. These are small, small things which keep on giving us that impetus, that momentum. We never look at numbers. We are not bothered whether 1,000 people are watching this FB Live or 10,000 people or whether it has gone viral or whatever it is. It is not important. It is you people, the few selected friends who are there, who not only listen, but who also comment, who come out with their own views. That is what I truly cherish all the time.
Surekha writes that one baggage I find hard to release is the way my mother handled her grief. I lost my father when I was 5 days old. My mother could never get over it and mourned this loss until she breathed her last at the age of 90. This baggage is stopping me from accepting my grief.
Absolutely, Surekha, absolutely. Imagine you were a newborn baby and your mommy lost her husband. Can we imagine what she must have been going through? A lady delivers her baby and immediately after that loses her husband. What sort of trauma she would have gone through? And unfortunately, as it does happen, she took it out in certain ways on the child. We have this Indian very unfortunate way of thinking that this one is lucky, that one is unlucky, this one is like that, this one is like that. So we start thinking, oh, she was born and my husband passed away, her father passed away. All these things, of course, now we can't do anything because she is no more. But even after so many years, I would still like you to resolve whatever you went through with your mother.
Smita thanks you and compliments you for being very inspiring, Ali.
Yeah, thank you, thank you.
And Nikat says that children can be wounded in multiple ways by bad things happening.
Yes.
Yes, but also by good things not happening, such as their emotional needs
Yes. I'm glad Nikat has brought up this point, you know, that certain things which you expect, for example, it is my birthday, I'm all of 4 years, 6 years, whatever I am. And suddenly something happens, there's a death in the family or daddy has to go out urgently or something is going wrong. And they say, no birthday celebration. Now to a little child, that little celebration of the birthday where you have a cake, you have candles and you cut the cake and everybody sings for you, just those few minutes of joy can give a lifelong pleasure to that child, right? But if the child doesn't get it, so exactly as Nikhat said, it is not even bad things happening to you. It is the absence of good things which you expected, which you felt were your right, which is the minimum that you wanted in life and you were denied that. This is only one example I'm giving you. It can happen in multiple ways.
Surekha has written that when she was in second standard, a bull chased her. Mm-hmm. And even today, even if a cow is grazing peacefully, the fear gets magnified and that the gravitational pull of this baggage prevents her from rising and taking responsibility for her choices.
Absolutely. This is one of the examples, very nice example. Glad you have shared it, Surekha. This is a typical example of how a small thing. Now, if you tell somebody that when I was a small child, there was this bull who chased me. So I feel upset now. People laugh. But that's not true. If that impact has caused a deep, you know, trauma in the mind and that still remains, it has to be resolved.
So Madanlal is also with us today. Good afternoon, Madanlal.
Most welcome, most welcome. And good afternoon to you also.
And Sugandhi has written that I generally resolve my relationships issues with most people, but the problem is this one person who hurts Every time I go with a clean slate to start afresh. Isn't relationship a two-way process?
Absolutely, absolutely, Sugandhi. Every relationship has to be two-way. There is no doubt about it. But let us also accept that there are certain people who just cannot maintain a good, happy and harmonious, you know, relationship. You have made all your efforts. You've tried your level best. You've tried number of times. For some reason or the other, the person is not reciprocating. Maybe the person is even creating more trauma and being bad to you in some way, which is causing you deeper hurt. The best thing to do is, if it is possible, physically get away from that person. If that is not possible for any reason, mentally get away from that person and say, I am not going to be affected by any of your words. I'm not going to make any efforts to re-establish our relationship. I'm just going to leave you as it is. And I have but much better people to interact with.
Surekha writes that while dealing with past baggage, it is important to realize that when there is no enemy within, the outside enemy can do us no harm.
Yes, very true. Very true. And as you said, Surekha, realizing this is very easy, but practicing it is very hard. That's one of the reasons why I take up all these topics and spend this hour with you all. Because this is to put the seeds. This is to make you aware. This is to make you, you know, give you that little motivation or impetus to start off. After that, a lot of practice has to be done. But it is worth it. Because any such change that we bring in is lifelong. It will, you know, transform your life and give you a little bit of joy. It enhances your quality of life for the rest of your life. So we owe it to ourselves to practice this thing.
Arina writes that accumulated stress can definitely stop you from growing and going forward in one's life.
Very true. If you are accumulating the stress, and that too from childhood, I believe that childhood stress is much, much more important than adult stress. Though we look at it the other way around, we are more concerned about what's happening in our adult life and we give more importance to it. We don't give importance to what happened in our childhood. But I would like to emphasize, please give more emphasis to your childhood stressors. How you have accumulated, those which were not resolved, those which were made worse by some, you know, some people being insensitive to you. Work it out. It's a slow process. Doesn't matter. Let it take its own time.
So Surekha writes that her mother was extremely principled and always encouraged her to reveal the best version of herself. This upbringing has made Surekha very sensitive and to any failing within me, and she finds it hard to forgive.
Very true, very true. So small, small things. I'm glad that Surekha is bringing out these, and I'm equally happy that she's sharing this you know, with us, because this is how we bring out things. So those of you courageous people who bring out your past or your, you know, experiences and share it with us on this platform, I'm really thankful to you, because you are the people who, you know, widen our horizons and our thinking, and each one of us can start thinking beyond the routine of what our life is being today.
Ali, Divya says that sometimes we take a lot of chances, that is to nurture our relationship by forgetting the old memories or misunderstanding, but other person will take us for granted.
Yeah.
And this sometimes leads to stress from these kind of relationships.
Good, you brought that up, Divya. When you say we forget, we actually push it from the conscious to the subconscious or unconscious mind. We are not completely forgotten. Those effects, those things still remain with us. But at the conscious level, because we are not thinking of it, we think, oh, everything is fine. And then when something hits us, we wonder why I'm reacting so badly, why I'm getting so hurt about it. So we cannot so easily forget childhood trauma unless and until we have resolved it. Unless we have actually taken out, you know, that each piece of the baggage and removed them and thrown them out from our backpack. Yes, I think we are coming to the end of the hour. Surekha has a nice comment. Go ahead.
My friend's nephew always places the keys of his happiness in somebody else's pocket. His colleagues steal his innovative ideas. He helplessly watches it and watches the daylight robbery. Ever since his childhood, his father kept on saying that he was not good enough and not smart enough. So though he has the knowledge and the skill, he does not have the self-esteem.
Exactly.
He cannot stand up for
it. That's another wonderful example that a capable young man, a person who can do so much, and he does also, he is working, he is doing something, but as Surekha said, in a very lighthearted way, he places the keys of the happiness in somebody else's pocket because he doesn't believe in himself. He wants only affirmations from others, but others don't react properly, no? They take away his ideas, they do whatever, and then they feel jealous of him and they keep away from him. These are some of the very, very negative outcomes that can happen. So please work on all these issues yourself, spread the word, tell other people. And I'm so thankful that you have contributed, each one of you, so much to this session. As I said, I'll be meeting you up next Saturday, that is on 18th, hopefully from the lovely environment of Manthan. And we'll talk about how to make friends with plants. Come with your own ideas and experiences. Thank you and bye-bye.